Let us understand the concept of exiting and traversing nerves. The first nerve that comes out of the spinal cord is the C1 nerve, which comes out above the lateral process of C1 vertebra. So the nerve which comes out from the C1 to neural foramen is the C2 nerve. Similarly, the nerve which comes out from the C3 to neural foramen would be the C4 nerve. So you have to remember that in cervical spine, the exiting nerve which comes out from the foramen is the larger numbered nerve. So the nerve which is coming out from C6-7 neural foramen will be the C7 nerve. From C7-D1 neural foramen, we have an additional nerve which is coming out, which is the C8 nerve, right? So this is the C7-D1 neural foramen. The nerve which is coming out is the C8 nerve, right? And from D1 to neural foramen onwards, the D1 nerve will come out. So in the dorsal and lumbar spine, the nerve which is coming out from the neural foramen has got a smaller number. The nerve which root coming out from D1 to neural foramen will be D1. One which is coming out from the D6-7 foramen will be D6. Similarly, the nerve root which is coming out from L4-5 neural foramen will be L4. Right. So the concept of traversing nerve comes in the dorsal and lumbar spine. The nerve, when exits from the spinal cord, traverses down to the next level and then comes out from the neural foramen at a lower level. So this is the traversing part of the nerve. This is the exiting part of the nerve. So this concept comes in the dorsal spine and lumbar spine. So we have got traversing nerve or traversing nerve and the exiting nerve in dorsal and lumbar spine. This is not the case in the cervical spine. So when we look at these exclusions, exclusion which is paracentral causes compression of the traversing nerve in the lateral recess, and when it is far lateral, it is called compression of the exiting nerve in the neural foramen. So that is the difference here. Coming to the anatomy of brachial plexus. So this is the colored illustration showing the different components of brachial plexus on the right side. The part here in golden color or yellow color is the roots. So these are the roots of brachial plexus. This is the C5, C6, C7, C8 and D1 roots. We know that the roots are formed by the ventral and dorsal rootlets. Along the dorsal rootlet, there's a dorsal root ganglion, right? So this is the pre-ganglionic segment of the root and this is the post-ganglionic segment. The roots in turn join to form the trunks of brachial plexus. The C5 and C6 roots join to form the upper trunk. C7 root continues as the middle trunk and the C8 D1 roots join to form the lower trunk. So the trunks traverse between the anterior and posterior scalene muscles. So after the roots, we have got trunks. Trunks will be passing between the scalene muscles, which are shown here. From the lateral margin of the scalene muscles to the upper margin of the clavicle, we have got the divisions. So roots, trunks, divisions. Each trunk will divide into anterior and posterior divisions. The divisions will join to form the cords. So the cords traverse from the level of clavicle up to the outer margin of the pectoral muscles. So these in pink color are the cords. And then the cords will give rise to terminal branches as the side branches, which are shown in the magenta color over here. So these are the roots, these are the trunks in blue, these are the divisions in turquoise or light blue color, these are the cords in pink color, and these are the branches in magenta. So this is a detailed anatomy now. The C5 and C6 roots join to form the upper trunk. So these are the scalene muscles. So and between the scalene muscles, we have got the trunks. C5 and C6 roots join to form the upper trunk. C7 root continues as the middle trunk. C8 and D1 roots join to form the lower trunk. The trunks divide into anterior and posterior divisions. These divisions join to form the cords. Now the posterior divisions of all the three trunks, upper, middle and lower, join to form the posterior cord. The anterior division of the lower trunk continues as the medial cord. And the anterior divisions of the upper and middle trunks join to form the lateral cord. So the cords extend from the level of clavicle up to the outer margin of the pectoral muscles. These are named medial, lateral, posterior depending on their relation to the subclavian artery. Right? So this is the subclavian artery here. The cord which is medial to it is a medial cord, one which is lateral is a lateral cord, and the cord behind or posterior is the posterior cord. These cords will then give rise to side branches and terminal branches. These are the terminal branches shown here. The medial cord will give rise to a branch which joins with another branch from the lateral cord from the median nerve. The ulnar nerve comes solely from the medial cord. Similarly, the musculocutaneous nerve comes solely from the lateral cord. And the posterior cord divides into two terminal branches, the axillary and the radial nerves. We'll not go into this part as of now. Second image here is the coronal oblique coronal T1 image, which shows the components of brachial plexus. These are the roots of brachial plexus. These are the levels of scalene muscles. So we have seen the trunks over here. These are the divisions from the outer margin of skeletal muscles up to the level of clavicle. These are the divisions. The divisions then join to form the cords. This is the asterisk here shows the subclavian artery. So the cord medial to it will be the medial cord. This is the lateral cord and posterior cords. So we have got sagittal images, sagittal T1 images here to show the relation of the cords to the subclavian artery. So this is the oblique sagittal image here. This is the subclavian artery, subclavian vein. The cord which is medial to it is the medial cord. The lateral cord is lateral to it, and this is the posterior cord. So this is the image obtained somewhat laterally at the level of axilla. So this is the subclavian artery. This is the cord which is medial, so medial cord. This is the posterior cord, and this is the lateral cord. Coming to the indications of brachial apex imaging, the most common indications as we know are trauma. Then we have gotten about compression or entrapment syndromes, imaging of inflammatory brachial plexopathy, and neoplasms. Most importantly, trauma. From a surgical and prognostic point of view, the injuries to brachial plexus are classified into three categories: preganglionic, postganglionic, and a combination of both. So preganglionic injuries largely comprise of nerve root avulsions. These require major procedure like neurotization. Postganglionic lesions are further classified into two lesions in continuity, which will require rehabilitation and neurolysis, and lesions with nerve discontinuity, like nerve transection or severe neurotomesis. These require nerve repair or grafting. So the overall spectrum of injuries ranges from neuropraxia or stress injury, which is most common, to axonotomesis, to partial neurotomesis with neuromyelin continuity formation, to complete nerve laceration or transections, severe neurotomesis or nerve avulsions. These categories here, severe neurotomesis, nerve transection, and nerve avulsions will require urgent surgery. Coming to interesting case here, this is a patient who has got injury, he has suffered a vehicle accident, and he has injury to the right arm and shoulder. He comes several weeks after the injury with complaints of right upper limb weakness and wasting. So when we do imaging of patients with brachial plexus, suspected brachial plexus injury, the first sequence that we take should always be a sagittal T2 sequence to the cervical spine. There is no point in imaging the brachial plexus for half an hour and saying that it is completely normal and then realizing that the patient has got cervical cord injury, something like a cord contusion or intramedullary hemorrhage, which would explain the complaints. So first and foremost, the first sequence should be a sagittal T2 sequence to the cervical cord. So this is a sagittal T2 image here from cervical spine. The cord looks perfectly fine. There's no obvious evidence of contusion or edema or hemorrhages. But when we come slightly far laterally on the right side, I'm seeing here that there are well-defined cystic lesions in the neural foramen at C6-7, C7-D1 and D1-2 levels here. So these are the exiting nerves which are looking intact, but in this neural foramina, there are cystic areas which could very well be traumatic pseudomeningocele. So when we take axial section, as we discussed earlier, this is the axial 3D space sequence. We can see that the ventral and dorsal rootlets are not seen at this level, C7 level. They are seen on the left side. And so there is complete nerve root avulsion of the right sided C1 root here. And there is the formation of a traumatic pseudomeningocele. This is nerve root avulsion. So these are 3D sequences, 3D stir sequences with deformations. Clearly show the traumatic pseudomeningocele form here at C6-7, C7-D1 and D1-2 levels. So these are involving the roots here. And these meningocele are then coalescing here to form a large pseudomeningocele sac. And the nerves here are retracted and edematous. So we can actually calculate the distance of retraction of the nerves from the insertion in the cord. So the surgeon can have a fair amount of idea about the surgical procedure to be taken. So this is a classical case of right brachial plexus injury with traumatic nerve avulsion and pseudomeningocele formation. These are 3D volume rendered images of the same patient. We can very nicely see the pseudomeningocele coalescing to form a big sac here. And these are the retracted edematous nerves of the brachial plexus. Another patient, a young adult with again a vehicle accident and a fracture in mid pora clavicle. He had a suspicion of brachial plexus injury, but he didn't immediately come up to the accident. He waited for some time. Treating surgeon gave him a few weeks time. When the patient did not recover after a few weeks, he still had upper limb weakness. The patient was sent for imaging. So these are the immediate CT scan images obtained immediately after trauma, which clearly show there is a immediate fracture here involving the mid part of the right clavicle. These are the volume rendered images. There's again a fracture here with some displaced bone fragment here. And when we did MRI scan of the brachial plexus a few weeks later, this is what we see. Again, the first sequence that we take is a sagittal T2 sequence to the cervical cord. The cervical cord here looks completely fine. So we move on to the brachial plexus part. These are coronal stir images. Now, this at this level, if you see, this is the area of fracture. So these are the cut ends of the bone. This is the callus formation around the fracture site. And these are the nerves of the brachial plexus. Now, if you see, all the components of brachial plexus, right from the trunks, divisions, cords, are all edematous. And I would call this something like a neuropraxia or nerve stretching, but then I would be wrong. Right? If I look carefully at this level, one of the nerves here is showing breach in continuity. When I do a volume rendering, this is what I see. So I need to evaluate this area better. And when I zoom it, this is what I see. Yes, definitely there's a transection of nerve. This is the middle trunk of the brachial plexus, which is showing complete loss in continuity. So this is nerve transection, severe injury involving the middle trunk of the brachial plexus, which would need a surgical repair. So from neuropraxia, we are moving to nerve transection. So we can see that this patient has got transection of the middle trunk of brachial plexus. The rest of the nerves in brachial plexus are showing changes of edema or neuropraxia. So this is definitely a candidate for surgery. Sometimes CT myelography is required. A patient who has got in areas where MR is not easily available, or patients who have got pacemakers who cannot be urgently taken for MRI. In such cases, CT myelography can be tried. This is a patient again with similar findings here. The ventral and dorsal rootlets are seen on the left side. On the right side, they are not seen. And we are seeing that there's contrast pooling here in a pseudomyelinosis sac here. So again, nerve avulsion on CT myelography. So this is the reporting format we sometimes follow. That is good to mention the report in two different parts, pre-ganglionic injury and post-ganglionic injury. So this is a patient with nerve avulsion at different levels. As we said, we have to mention whether the nerve avulsion was pre-ganglionic part. And in the post-ganglionic part, obviously, there will be changes of neuropraxia and nerve transection or axonal based on neurotomiasis. Coming to bony impingements. Now, this is an interesting case of a young student. He's a medical graduate and he has got intermittent brachial plexopathy involving the left upper limb. The X-ray here clearly shows there are cervical ribs. The smaller cervical rib on the right side and larger one on the left side. The left side cervical rib here is seen to articulate the mid part of the left first rib. So how does this affect the brachial plexus? Let us see. We have a set of coronal images here, oblique coronal images showing brachial plexus. These are the nerves of brachial plexus. So this would be level of the roots, the trunks and divisions of the brachial plexus, and this would be level of the cord because this is the clavicle. We'll just go to the next image here. Again, the nerves of brachial plexus nicely seen. Now this is the left-sided cervical rib. And in this image, you can clearly see that the rib is articulating with the left first rib, and this articulation is very closely abutting and impinging on the roots of brachial plexus. So this is site of the articulation, and these are the level of trunks and cords of the brachial plexus, the divisions and cords of the brachial plexus. These are getting impinged. So whenever the patient has got something, abduction, extrusion of the left upper limb, the nerves of brachial plexus are impinged by the cervical rib. So this patient was subjected to surgery, the cervical rib was removed, and he did have improvement in the complaints. Another patient presented with upper extremity pain, but he also had, on further probing, we told history of weight loss and loss of appetite since few months. The image here clearly shows the well-defined mass in the apical part of the left hemithorax. It is seen to be infiltrating the surrounding fat pins. The fat pins on the right side are intact. And on the next image here, it clearly shows that there is some invasion of the D1 root of the brachial plexus and maybe the lower trunk. So this is the classical case of pancostumor of left lung, which is invading the brachial plexus. Another patient, adult female patient, who's treated for CA breast. She has got nodular lesions along the nerves of brachial plexus, which are classical of metastasis involving the brachial plexus. Another young adult female patient with right upper limb complaints. The image itself is very characteristic. We have got a dumbbell-shaped lesion, which is coming out from the neural foramen with well-defined margins. This is most likely a nerve-shaped tumor involving the brachial plexus. A patient, a 38 years old male patient who had history of vehicle accident a few months back. Now he has, after a few months, he has come with complaints of right brachial plexopathy. This image here clearly shows a well-defined lesion, obliterated lesion with two differential intensities. The central part here, this impact is a pseudoaneurysm involving the subclavian artery, which is causing right-sided brachial plexopathy. Another elderly female patient who has received radiotherapy for CA breast 7 months back, she presents with brachial plexopathy. Now, in this case, there are no nodules along the nerves, so we don't see any obvious metastasis, but there is increased intensity of the cords of brachial plexus here. and these might show increased enhancement. So this is in all likelihood, since the patient has got CLF, breast shear disc radiotherapy. So this is post-radiation plexopathy of the brachial plexus. Another adolescent girl, now she has got similar findings as the earlier patient. There is extensive edema and hyperintensity involving the roots, trunks, and cords of brachial plexus. But she didn't have any previous history. She had a small episode of viral illness 1 or 2 weeks back. So in all likelihood, this could be something like Parsonage Turner syndrome, inflammatory brachial plexopathy. So before ending, a brief information about some of the imaging MRI techniques that we can use for brachial plexus imaging. DTI, or diffusion tensor imaging, which measures diffusion of water in 3D space over milliseconds of time, to give indication of tissue alteration. It has got high sensitivity for detecting changes in tissue anisotropy. So this is very similar to DTI that we take to ascertain the integrity of the longitudinal white matter tracts in brain. And this is still an imaging technique. This brings me to the end of the presentation. I hope you enjoyed this presentation and found it informative. Thank you.